I think the question is agreed by a majority of members present. I declare the motion passed.
根據公共財政條例
Proposed resolution under Public Finance Ordinance. Members who wish to speak, please press the requested speak button. I call Public Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury to speak and move the motion. President, I move that motion as printed on the agenda be passed. The purpose of this motion is to seek funds on account to enable the government to carry on its services between the start of the financial year on the 1st of April 2019 and the time when the Appropriation Ordinance 2019 comes into operation. This is a long established and essential procedure. The specific arrangements also follow those of recent years. According to the budget timetable this year, the Legislative Council will resume the second reading debate of the Appropriations Bill 2019 at its meeting on 8th of May 2019. As such, the Appropriation Ordinance 2019 will not be coming into operation before 8th of May 2019. To ensure that the government will not need to halt public services, including services closely related to people's livelihoods such as education, social welfare, healthcare, and security due to the lack of funds when the new financial year starts on 1st of April, we need to propose this motion. According to the funds on account sought under each subpart in accordance with the fourth paragraph of the resolution have been determined with a reference to the relevant provisions in the 2019-20 estimates of expenditure. The initial amount of funds on account under each head which has been incorporated requirements at subhead level is provided in form of a footnote to the speech. In gist, the proposed funds on account should be able to cope with around 2 months of government operation requirements. The aggregate amount of funds on account is $131.81699 billion before the Appropriation Ordinance 2019 comes into operation. This represents 25% of the total appropriations of the $515.794785 billion under Appropriation Bill 2019. Subject to the above aggregate amount not being exceeded, the resolution enables the Financial Secretary to vary the funds on account in respect of any subhead, but these variations must not exceed the provision for that subhead in the 2019-20 estimates of expenditure. To enhance transparency and in line with the established practice, we'll report to the Finance Committee of this Council if the Financial Secretary had exercised his authority to meet necessary requirements. The government has to make payments for a large number of expenditure items every day, taking the first week between 1st of April and 7th of April of 2019-20 financial year as an example. Numerous government expenditure items had to be settled during the week, include A, subvention payments of around $5.7 billion to the Hospital Authority, B, payments for the comprehensive social security assistance and social security allowance totaling around $1.4 billion to about 130,000 families and 150,000 individuals respectively. C, grants of around $1.6 billion to UGC-funded universities. D, subvention payments of around $700 million to the Vocation Training Council. E, subsidies of around $600 million to about 750 kindergartens. And F, pension gratuities of around $600 million to retired civil servants. There are also other expenses such as salaries of contract staff as well as account payables to suppliers. It takes at least 2 to 3 working days for government departments and banks to process a large amount of payments made by auto pay. It also takes some days to complete the statutory procedure after the passage of the vote on account resolution, including the gazetteer process and procedure for issuance of the vote of account warrant, so that the government can make payments starting from the 1st of April as usual. In order to ensure that the government has the necessary resources to continue those services provided to the public, I urge members to support this motion today. The vote on account will be subsumed under the Appropriation Ordinance 2019 upon its enactment and commencement. President, I beg to move. I now move that the motion as the question moved by the Secretary passes. Does any member wish to speak? Mr. Ray Chen. Thank you, Madam Deputy. Today is the 20th of March.
It'll be about 10 days before we start the new fiscal year on the 1st of April. As usual, the Secretary said that vote on account is very important because it takes a certain number of days for funds to be transferred, and we need to put in place administrative measures. So you will need to approve the vote on account, otherwise the government will run out of funds. This is only a show. If they indeed are in urgent need of funds, then they wouldn't have waited till today to do it. 2 weeks ago, there were no meetings in the LegCo because, Madam Deputy, you had to go to Beijing to attend the NPC, SC, as well as the CPPCC meeting. And now you say that today this bill, this resolution has to be passed. But you don't have to worry. We don't have to continue with the debate until tomorrow. There are only about a handful of members who would like to speak. This is the seventh year of my being legislator, and I have spoken every year. You may call this going through the motion. I do know that whether I speak or not, whether I vote against it or not, this resolution is going to be passed. But I would like to tell the public that it is going to be 131,081,699,000, which equals to about 25% of the total appropriation. This is an astronomical amount. In the past, it would take less than an hour for this resolution to be passed, and there wasn't any division claimed either, but this time it's going to be different. I will definitely claim a division. I will not support the resolution. People who would support the vote on account resolution, you should not do so without any condition, because this is a mini budget. They ask for a quarter of the funds required. The budget this year is the worst of all, the worst in history. The popularity rating of the financial secretary, Paul Chan, has plummeted to a new low. Well, in the past, I dubbed John Zhang's budget as a scam, but I think this year, Paul Chan's budget is worse than even a scam. There may be a reduction in surplus. The financial secretary has set aside huge funds to tip towards the rich and the powerful. We have about $5.5 billion for Phase 2 Cyberport, about $7.7 billion to Science Park. When it comes to rates, refund, about $15 billion will go to conglomerates. If you're just a small owner, you will get less than $6,000. For the resumption of the second debate of the budget, I will criticize in detail the budget. We think that the budget is unjust and should not be supported. The vote on account will be about 25% of the total appropriation, so I am going to say the following based on that. You may think, well, it's very simple. It's a vote on account. You have to pay. If you veto it, there will be a physical cliff, and Hong Kong will be ground to a halt. The government will stop operating. But I'd like to take the opportunity of debating on the resolution on the vote on account, namely a quarter of the total appropriation, to tell everyone about the performance of government officials, especially those in the Treasury and the financial services, whether this resolution and the budget should be supported without any conditions. The budget cannot be changed. Members may submit amendments, but I think they're tightening the grip. The chance that amendments will be allowed is slimmer, And of course, the chance of our amendments being passed is close to zero. Still, I will use every chance to say my piece. But there is the new low of the popularity rating of Paul Chan is minus 30. On the day of the budget, it was 47.1 on the budget, a drop of 1.1 points compared to last year. But now, the chief secretary and financial secretary don't think twice about this. They think, well, it doesn't say that the public think say that it is unacceptable. The voter account contains one-fifth of the pay of Paul Chan. You only have to go outside to ask people. Ask grassroots, especially those have not, they don't receive any rates refund, any tax refund. They are self-reliant, they don't have CSSA. Last time there was the care and share scheme, $4,000. He said that, well, you criticized me, so this time I'm not going to launch that again. So do you think that he's worth his salt? No, not at all. He should be asked to step down. He should just take the budget back and redo it. To veto the vote on account is to refuse to pay Paul Chan for 2 months or so. And I have some advice to give to members from the business sector. This also contains the remuneration of the Secretary for Justice as well as the Secretary for Security. What are we working on recently? The amendment to the Fugitive Offenders Ordinance. Everyone's saying that it's making their opinions known, but it looks like that the administration and the Secretary will not accept any advice. I think if you continue to pay them by endorsing the vote on accounts is to allow them to be pig-headed. So I appeal to you to vote against the vote on account resolution to make clear your stance. You need to send the administration a very clear message that you do not agree with the amendment to the Fugitive Offenders Ordinance. Carrie Lam, in the past day or so, put up a show saying that it has to be endorsed in July because we do need to make sure that justice is done in relation to the Taiwanese case. Well, if you want to stop them from doing something bad, if you want them to take their foot off the pedal, then I appeal to members in the business sector. Even if you can't stop the vote on account, well, if you don't want to vote against it, you may abstain. These are ways to send a very clear message to the Secretary for Justice and the Secretary for Security that you don't want them to go ahead. We are talking about $131 billion under the vote on account. Of course, it also comprises the pay for secretaries for bureaus. There are a number of them that I don't think should be paid. That is the WizKid secretary, the one with the high IQ, where it's been quite quiet in recent days, but last month, I think had us for fools. He took us for fools last month about the elderly CSSA eligibility criteria. He said that is going to be the age eligibility is going to be increased from 60 to 65. Mrs. Carrie Lam even said to Miss Eunice Yong that, well, you endorsed it in the first place. So people who are going to be 60, to be over 60, should I be voting for or against? on something that will pay the wages to Lo Chi Kwong. You could just go and ask people. I don't think people want to support Dr. Lo Chi Kwong, not even 1 second. The last time you used the budget, you hit something bad in it to try to muddle through with the increase of age eligibility of elderly CSSA. I'm sure that in the committee stage of the appropriation bill, there will be amendments to try to dock their pay. Well, if the establishment won't do it, I will. And this will give us all a chance to speak on this. I think you took us for fools and tried to, you betrayed us. You didn't say anything when you hit something in the budget. If you support the votes on account, that means you think that it's okay for the secretary and the government to pull a fast one on us. So whether it is the vote on account or the appropriation bill, people just go through the motion. Some people may say, well, of course, the 60 members in the LegCo, they all have an axe to grind. Should you veto the vote on account resolution and the appropriation bill simply because of that? Exactly. That is exactly the way to exert pressure on the administration. The loyalists, of course, think that you can't even criticize the administration. I was going to ask you to join me, Madam Deputy. If they don't withdraw the proposal to increase the age eligibility of elderly CSSA, we would all vote against the vote on account unless you would concede. But now the administration wouldn't even budge an inch. They don't think they have done anything wrong. Over the years, the LegCo has slighted the importance of the vote on account. As the secretary said, that is a long-established and essential procedure. Of course, they wouldn't go as far as to say that it's going through the motion, but we all know full well what that's exactly what it is. Members may not even speak on the resolution, but what I'd like to point out is that if they are so blasé about the whole thing, it is not a frequent occurrence. Say, for example, in the US, well, when they debate on appropriation, they would use various ways, you may call it filibustering, to try to get what they want. In the past few months, whether you are from the Democratic camp or you are pro-government, we are very angry about your changing of the age eligibility of elderly CSSA. If we can work together to oppose to the vote on account and the appropriation bill, well, even if we can't stop it, that at least don't give them so many support votes. Give us about a dozen veto votes. On the 20th, I'm sure that is the appropriation bill is going to be voted to pass. But at least give us more votes against it. I think, bill with the biggest binding effect will be the appropriation bill. The next one will be the vote on account. If you use this to lean on the administration, it will be most effective. This is a very good way to lean on government officials. Think about the elderly CSSA, whether it's Dr. Lo Chi Kwong or Carrie Lam. Look at their attitude. If we can veto the vote on account, you don't have to go so far as veto the appropriation bill. You can continue to support it. If you vote against the vote on account, I'm sure that immediately they will lower the age of elderly CSSA. However, whether you are pro-government or media that is pro-government, they smear us, saying that we are people who try to stop the governance of the administration. I think that's a wrong mentality because we don't want the LegCo to become a rubber stamp. We don't want the administration to just go through the motions and saying that they respect us, but they don't. So in face of the bill with the biggest binding effect, that is the appropriation bill, and the votes on account resolution, we need to exert the most pressure on the administration so that they will know that they are wrong and they will make changes to benefit Hong Kong people, even if it's just a change in one or two policies. So I appeal to you to vote against the vote on account resolution.
Dr. K.K. Kwok, Madam Deputy, Mr. Ray Chen made a brilliant speech. We do have convention here. The convention is that for this vote on account, we need this to pay for the officials. And should we observe this convention and pass it? But the administration is not observing the convention. They are always on a collision course with the public. They cited a figure of $624 billion yesterday to build this project, which is very much a scam for Hong Kong. And they said that this is less than $1 trillion, that this is for the benefit of Hong Kong. This vote on account is meant for the government emoluments. How are they dealing with the infrastructure developments? We have overspending at a level which is amazing. Lantown, 54%. Hong Kong Zhuhai Bridge, Hong Kong Link, 55%. Central Wan Chai Link, 88%. The expressway, 36%, Tuen Mun Road, 47%. All these are figures of overspending. Michael Wong said yesterday that at most it would be only 10%. They are putting together all these minor projects and present a figure of 10%. This is ridiculous. The MTRC has resumed service just today. What happened a couple of days ago could have been fatal. What has Frank Chen done? Frank Chen and the government appointed the MTRC board. They are the major shareholder, the Sha Tin Central Line, the railway MTR collision, and all these are serious matters. You tell the people of Hong Kong that we're sitting on a lot of money and that these human lives are at stake. They are supposed to come here for an urgent question, but we don't have it today. Frank Chen is hiding in his office, not saying anything. No. They say that this is a mere $131 billion and we should endorse this VOC. Now, part of the money is for the CSSA, head 179, 30% of the budget is devoted to CSSA here. The eligibility threshold has been increased, and those between 60 and 64 have been excluded from the CSSA. And now we are asked to pay 30% of the expenditure, and this is really ghastly to look at. The government is so atrocious that it is beyond description. We can see that the government's rating is really dipping. Frank Chen and Theresa Chang, they are hitting new lows. When they first came to office, they talked about a new style of governance. What have they done? They forgot about the measures that are good for the public, and they are seeking funding here very quickly, and they said that they would monitor the projects, and overspending is at a level that would enable us to pay for the universal retirement protection three times over. Carrie Lam sought to alleviate poverty, but the more she does this, the poorer people are. We're not asking for too much, we're asking for better livelihood. The daily lives, the daily necessities, there are an increasing number of people in subdivided units, and these officials, we can't count on them to deliver the public housing. We're talking about a waiting time of 5.5 years. Very soon it's going to be 7 years. And this is leaving us in tears. We are endorsing today this vote on account to pay for their emoluments. I mean, we were made to feel guilty not to endorse this proposal. At this day and age, with the support of the pro-establishment members, we have degenerated into an appalling state. This VOC is a good opportunity for us to criticize the government. Now, of course, unlike the appropriation bill, we cannot dock the wages, dock the pay of the top officials, because this is a lump sum amount. There is no there are no breakdowns to speak of. But we must be aware that today all the livelihood issues, accommodation, they're talking big, but they're delivering virtually nothing. Hospitals. The flu surge hasn't been behind us. Yesterday, the admission rate has been hitting new high. All the patients, if they're poor, they'll be miserable. From 1997, the number of beds has come down from 29,000 to 28,000. We have more. We have a higher population, but the number of beds is decreasing. And they're seeking more than $10 billion to upgrade the hospital with an additional 80 beds. Patients are lying outside the toilets. They're lying in the corridors, and they still get paid nonetheless. And they couldn't care less about the popularity rating. They couldn't care less about the popularity rating because they're going to win at the end of the day. We cannot stomach that. We are getting the third world level of care in terms of elderly care, in terms of healthcare level. We are spending 2.9% of the GDP on the healthcare, comparable to the third world level. If you look on the web, you get to see that Hong Kong is infamous for being too expensive. Hong Kong is also infamous for the most appalling living condition. They're living in the 80 square foot kind of accommodation with everything, toilet and everything inside this floor space. Frank Chan said that he's doing a lot. They're providing the temporary accommodation. What sort of government is this? We passed the bill regarding tax deduction. It's hard to block this. Maybe they're reading too much of the Bible. Those who can afford the $60,000 contribution, they will get more deduction. Of course, the business sector will stand to benefit more. The banking sector, the insurance sector will stand to benefit a lot. The poor who cannot even afford the $60,000, all they can do is to wait for the handouts. It's not easy to get the handouts in the first place. The $4,000 handout, it cost a furore. $1.4 billion in handout cost us $300 million in administrative fees. We are nostalgic about John Deng, and the handout scheme is really in chaos. And eventually they had to make concessions and relax about the residential proof. They are going through the motion. Mr. Andrew Wan is here. We are paying for the Secretary for Justice, and she is riding roughshod over the members, and members are prosecuted for assault. We're here to give a voice to the public. Every single dollar spent on us is some taxpayers' money. And they are using the taxpayers' money to harass the unpopular members here. And they are conjuring up all manner of reasons to disqualify some of the members that they don't like. The CMAB, the Secretary for Justice, these atrocious officials are really making the governance even worse. And you're asking us to go through the motion and vote through the vote on account. Wouldn't you feel shameful? The members of the public and the traveling public will have to pray when they get on the MTR. What government is this? They said that they've done their best. Someone who's been there for 30-odd years, and she's got a lot of experience in administration, and she's leading this team really proudly some years ago, and people these days are really in really appalling conditions, and all their expectations are not really met. They said that tomorrow you're going to be in for better days. When they're seeking funding here, they will be very high-handed. They're going to get $500 million for this study, and there will be more on the way. Now, we talked about the scams, and this is what they are perpetrating. It's just like sweet-talking people into paying the down payment and then meet the mortgage payments and so on for new cars and things. And when people default in their payment, they would say that I never thought you couldn't pay for the amount. Now, there was that the officials are posted in and out. Mr. Lau, Mr. Michael Wong, he's younger, he may be still there. 777 may have to go by the time this is completed. And they may say that they've got some wrong. It's just like slashing the CSSA for the elderly. Now, they said that we've agreed to that in the budget debate, and at that time they might say that you've already committed to it and you have to get on with it. This $624 billion, once they have poured the filling, the public fill in, there is no going back. There may be another $600 billion or double that, and you still have to pay for it nonetheless. The public will have to tighten their belt, and the administration might tell them that the government is running out of money, and we've done our best. You shouldn't expect too much from the government. We have spent a lot on the hospital authority, $400 million more for the HA to buy drugs, and they're spending more than $10 billion on the switch plant. Infrastructure is something that will benefit so many people. The contractors and all these contractors with a certain background, they will stand to benefit a lot from these projects. And this is a really appalling government. They are saying that this vote on account is for the benefit of the public. because they have to pay for the underprivileged. All this is a pack of lies. If we do not scrutinize the details and seek explanation, would they bother? We may talk about this until we're blue in the face, and this will be voted through in any case. We simply cannot allow the government to go on like this. Thank you.
Members, may I remind you, now we're debating on the proposed resolution on the public finance ordinances so that they can request for refunds on accounts so that upon the start of new financial year in 4th of April and until the vote on the Appropriations Bill 2019, to allow the government continue to operate. The expenditure have been explained, unlike what the members said, which include infrastructure. So, and also, member, please focus on today's vote on the account resolution. Mr. Al-Lakhin, Madam Deputy, please don't be worried. I wonder if I can use my 15-minute slot, but I will focus on public finance. We have a gaping problem in Hong Kong. Today, the resolution and the public finance ordinance, I have grave reservations. Last year, when I first entered LegCo, immediately we need to face the same resolution, which is like the first or second time sitting on the council. I noticed that Mr. Wei Chan last year also discuss on the important issue. Why did the LegCo for years have overlooked this vote on account resolution? Just go through the motions. There are so few members have spoken that only a few have spoken before it passed. He claimed this as a rare phenomenon. I kept this in mind, and so this year I'm prepared to speak. Last October, when we deliberate on the green bond scheme resolution, we were given a very precious lesson. And under wording, under resolution, don't need to outline the policy objectives and claim that I want to issue bonds and ask us to approve it. Well, regardless of any resolution, including this one, that would have pay as attention, especially on public finance. The basic law empowered the LegCo to do so is our duty. And for the past few years, the debate on the bill of accounts resolution does involve a lot of livelihood arrangements and the relevant arrangements for public services. Thus, the members shouldn't get into the way and approve quickly, otherwise the government not able to operate as normal. Well, I hope they could pay attention to a few other things. The resource from the vote on account will only be devoted on the public services. Yes, I agree, but it's purely for public services. If not, we must ask, what are the use for the provisions? As heard from the secretary, they claim that you can just add EGC, VTC, and retirement payments. They will agree that these are the public services vital, needed by the public. However, doing some simple math, the items mentioned by the secretary together to add up to $16 billion in total. And now the government had requesting $131.8 billion for the. So how urgent for the other $12 billion? What are they about? I want to have a closer look. However, if the government did not account comprehensively or submit a detailed report to LegCo, I believe that this will become a black hole. In accordance of 7.1, on the amount of requested on vote and account have increased by the year, and at a staggering rate. So back in 2009, I wonder if you can see it from your seat, to 2010, the votes on account will be at $61 billion or $585 billion, And for the years, have been between 60 to 70 billion. For 2016, it been rising quite quickly. And this year, you have been exceeded 100 billion. For 2016, it's 90.4 billion, and now the surge passed 100 billion. So over the decade, excluding inflation, we have been spending more, and actually doubled in 10 years. So behind this rise, what fiscal discipline are you showing? Which area have led to the most dramatic surge? Is that fighter to the public? If we simply go through the motions while ignoring the changes in our spending, there may not be a benefit to the society. Well, for livelihood, government operations are important. Shouldn't we seriously examine the legal basis behind this public expenditure? Every year we claim this is a funds on account. Have you actually looked at the resolution itself? So for the Public Finance Ordinance 7.1, what does it cover? And what are the funding criteria? Allow me to quote for 7.1. The legislature before that subject to resolution, the sum may be charged to be expended against head expenditure shown in expenditures laid before the Legislative Council. However, it must proceed conditions. It doesn't seem to have a direct relation to this funds on account. So what conclusion can we arrive from the past debate on the VOA? Last week, a lot of pro-establishment camp and the Madam Deputy went to Beijing for the two Congress, and therefore, the legislature have been deprived of the time to scrutinize the appropriation bill and its vote on accounts. I don't see this practice desirable. Looking in 2018 to 19, the House Committee had formed into a subcommittee on vote on accounts. Well, actually, took 2 weeks on focus on the vote on account resolutions. The chairman was James Cho on my left. I noticed he is present. He raised a few points to the government. One, the government should only apply for funds on account on non-urgent items instead of claiming all of them are provisions and apply for all sorts of funds on account. You have to tell what are the urgent and necessary ones. You have to highlight them to me. If you bury it in the total figure, it's pointless. And the funds on account should be mentioned after we submit the appropriations bill. And before moving the resolution, give us sufficient notice so that the legislature will have sufficient time to scrutinize the VOA resolution. Even though it's provisional, you can give us notice in advance. You have to review that is necessary to as per the resolution on the and authorizing the finance secretary to approve the finance secretary. I noticed in the 2008 subcommittee suggestion from Sun Chang to Paul Chan, from Hakakun to Mr. James Lau, the government had not responded to Leshko's suggestions. But why after announcing the appropriations bill as an administrative measure, I didn't see government making improvements? Have Mr. James Lau actually improved the notice back in 2008? We have suggested the government hope to enhance its approach. Can the government tell the public, out of this 131 billion, which of them are urgent and necessary, and what is the percentage? Also notice that each year, the government apply for provision according to 4A for an operating account, recurrent account, subpet of expenditure equivalent to 20% of the provision, and 4B, these 100% of the provision showing an estimate in respect of the subpet. And paragraph 4, putting the set differentiated by operating account and recurring subpet and non-recurring subpet. We also see exceptions. In the schedule, there are two subpets, one cap 152 and one cap 155, which are CEDB and the ITC. And now the administration has requested to apply for 25% of the total appropriation as provision. Why had it boost to 25%? But why only these two departments need to have provision? What are they planning? We have no idea. It's like some urban legend. We haven't got answers for so long. The third one concerning the authority of the finance secretary. That the last bit of the fourth paragraph, or any such amount, and not exceeding an amount equivalent of 100% of the provision shown in as amended any case be approved by the finance secretary. It should be titled as C, which authorized the financial secretary. Okay, in any case, be approving any amount of provision. And Emily Lau back in 2008 said this. Even the legal advisor at the meeting have asked what is the true meaning of this paragraph, but nobody can give an answer. That's outrageous. For so long, the financial secretary has used his authority to approve of any revision. Or he came that you have never invoked this authority. But in case you have used it, I wonder how do you exercise this power? Well, I call this resolution black holes. This didn't come overnight. For so many years, the government had failed to respond to legal questions and had no plans to improve their accountability. And for this public finance black hole is getting wider with the amount of being sought getting more. At the yesterday press conference on Lantau tomorrow, we call them misleading estimates. I'm baffled. Well, you have no idea how much the CSAM will cost in future. Or all the revenue from land sales is all simply projections. And you mislead the public that you will definitely reach that number, and at the end you will only overrun your budget. So I don't want our public finance to take shape like this. I would vote against this resolution. If any other colleagues, especially the pro-establishment camp, will claim, oh, you all feel it bustering to affect the livelihood and affecting public government operations, I hope we can stop debating about this. That's not my intention. It appears to be reasonable that you don't speak. If members do not fulfill his duty in scrutinizing the resolution, there will be a dereliction of duty. Well, Madam Deputy, Mr. Lan Jicheng said, do you want to comb through the entire appropriations bill with bit by bit? It seems that the dead body is still in the morgue. Well, I suppose we have to cut it up, shouldn't we? Well, let me reiterate. I'm not standing against public services and no one want to get in the way of government operations. I'm against the public finance institution that lack accountability, which is exposed through this PFO ordinance. It seems that it's certain to get what it want and arrogant. I think it would examine the calculation for the vote of funds on account, so assure the public, so submit.
Mr. James Toh, Madam Deputy. Well, I was quite happy because Mr. Aounokin has quoted something that I have been chanting like a slogan every single year. Well, you propose a budget and you have to consider a lot of things. It covers many different areas and it's of a very wide scope. There is a necessity to get vote on account. Mr. Aounokin has gone into details, which saves me a lot of time. Well, the government said that they have exercised restraint, they have been very careful, they have carefully considered what is necessary and what is not. As a result, they will not get more than necessary. A lot of members have put in much effort to mention these areas. From the perspective of public administration, some people may think, well, you provide convenience to others as long as you work up a formula that will do. So you can see the stark difference between people in different positions. I'm not going to go into detail. The second point I'd like to say is that we're setting aside what I've said in the first point. The vote on account will give us 2 or 3 months to consider possible amendments to the appropriation bill. We will be able to highlight certain points to the administration here without waiting for the appropriation bill. After the budget was announced on the 28th of February, people found it quite unpalatable about one thing, because allocation is not even. I'm not going to give you the figures. Of the 40 billion relief measures, well, 30 billion dollars, 80% goes to rate, waiver and tax refund. But they have left out those have not, namely university students, those who earn very little, as well as housewives. These people account for about 3 million of our population. I'd like to take this opportunity to remind the administration that you have to be mindful to ensure that there is even distribution. Please use the mechanism of the previous year and give $3,000 to those who have not. I'm going to dispense with the details. This will affect the decision of the Democratic Party. Last year, it was unfair. You tried to remedy the situation, but even before you've completed that work, you've forgotten about that. The financial secretary has been adamant that there won't be any more cash handouts. Do you want people to come out to march en masse? I ask the administration to take this opportunity to listen to members as well as the public. Some members may not agree with me about giving cash handouts indiscriminately. Well, when a lot of people have benefited from the budget and they benefit for more than 3,000, then you have to think about whether it is fair, instead of thinking about how much each person will get. Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Gary Chen.
Thank you, Madam Deputy. I was sitting here listening to members' views regarding this VOC My view is that there are two areas of misunderstanding which I'd like to seek clarifications. Before I do so, I go along with Mr. James Toe that there is a need for the vote on account because until the appropriation bill is enacted, there should be some funding available to meet the day-to-day expenditure. I heard I listened to the PANDEM members that there are two areas that are less than accurate. They are talking basically about policies. It's got no direct relationship with this VOC account. Some mentioned the overspending, and some members adopted the attitude of objecting to the government, and therefore they should slash some of the spending here. The VOC doesn't actually include the infrastructural projects and the policy matters that they were alluding to a moment ago. They don't belong here in this context. They should take the matter up at the panel meetings instead. And we ought to have the endorsement of the Finance Committee before the funding would be dispersed. So they talk about the overspending of the infrastructural projects. They fall outside the context of this VOC. This is a really a kind of misunderstanding. Second, I think that they are really too sweeping in their arguments, and because they are not happy with certain officials, and therefore we have to slash the expenditure. But in this vote on account, it covers a broad spectrum. If you refer to the administration's paper, you have a whole list of items here. If they merely single out some of the departments that they don't like and reject this VOC, it will be less than fair. There are important expenditures here, like the Fire Services Department, civil servants, pensions, and more importantly, 112, there's the Electrical Commission. Madam Deputy, we can express our displeasure with the officials. Some members of the public are terribly unhappy with the council. They said that some members are flouting the rules of procedure. They're yelling from their seats. They should have their wages docked. So shouldn't we consider slashing or have some discussion on the budget for the Electrical Commission? If the members disagree with the vote on account, I hope that they would stop getting paid for the next couple of months, and whether they have any reimbursable amount for their assistance. It's no good for them to just shout at the officials. The voting down of this vote on account would have significant implications. Just because they're not happy with the policies, and just because they are not happy with certain officials, doesn't mean that they should veto the vote on account in its entirety, because that would impinge on the operation of the government and also on the functioning of the Electrical Commission, also members' offices. Thank you. Does any other member wish to speak?
如果沒有,我請局長答辯,
and now I'm put debate to a close. Secretary. Madam Deputy, allow me to supplement that this 2019 vote on accounts is being scrutinized by the Finance Committee by 8th to 12th of April during the special FC meeting. The members can ask questions on these different policy spheres. And for 17-18, on the second reading of the budget, I agree with Gary Chan. We now request the government to support this funding resolution that allow at the beginning of the financial year, 4th of April, before the passage of the Appropriations Bill 2019, to obtain the resource it need to push ahead of livelihood-related services. And now I have a question to you that the motion moved by the Secretary be passed. And for those in favor, please raise your hands. And Mr. Alahin claims with division. The bell will be rung.
开始 表决.
Voting begins. Please check your vote. Voting is now stopped. Please show the results. 51 present, 39 for, 10 against, 1 abstentions. I think the question is agreed with a majority of the members present. I declare the motion passed.
议员就附属法例或
Members' motion on subsidiary legislation.